Started in 1997, the VSC has been active in campus with the unbroken continuity for the past 15 years, while managed and run entirely by successive generations of students. Vivekananda Study Circle, right from its inception, has been fortunate to get immense support from the institute administration. Former director Dr. N.V.C. Swami gave a formative direction during VSC's earlier days. We are delighted to have with us our director, Professor Bhaskar Ramamurthy. I would like to invite our director to give an inaugural address to this symposium.
Thank you very much, and very good evening to all of you. Swami Atma Shraddhananda Ji, Sri Shraddhalu Ranade, other Swamiji's, and other dignitaries who have come to this function from off campus, my colleagues and students from our campus. Well, I would like to first, on behalf of the institute, welcome all of you to this gathering. We are very fortunate to have been given this kind of an environment in which we can live and study. And it's very nice to see when the available facilities are put to various kinds of good use. And therefore, it is an obvious conclusion that any administration will come to that any such activities of this kind, like the Vivekananda Study Circle, have to be encouraged as much as possible, with all throwing open all the facilities that are available in the institute. So we have no hesitation, as my predecessors in the past, and I'm sure my successors in the future, in supporting this activity. Actually, the size of the audience in this function is quite good, because there are many technical conferences that take place here in very specialized areas in which the audience is even less than half of this, because it's a very specialized area. This is not so specialized, and yet I would say this is a very pretty good audience, so I think that also makes me very happy. I was not sure whether there'll be this many people. I am very sure you'll find the evening to be very rewarding, and probably tomorrow's function too. There are only a few. So the other thing is, I'm very happy that this study circle, which is a voluntary club, if you want to call it that way, we have so many activities like this on campus, started by students, that it has continued unabated for 15 years. So more or less, it is here to stay. And that's a very good sign, because we must remember that the students who are the backbone of this are transient. It's not the same people who have run this from the first day. So if something is thriving, you know, the way our heritage thrives, though different generations come and go, then it is something to be cherished and be proud of. Now, of course, there is behind this that glue that holds it together from the Ramakrishna Mission. And currently, Swami Atma Shraddhananda Ji is giving them the support that is needed in order to keep this circle alive and well. The institute is very grateful to the Ramakrishna Mission and to Swamiji in particular for the interest and support that they have, and the support they provide to this study circle. On this, there are only very few thoughts that I want to share with you on this, on the topic of this two-day symposium. If we ask ourselves, what are the main differentiators that sort of, you know, really, I mean, at the core, differentiate Indian thought, Indian heritage from the thought and heritage elsewhere in the world? My humble view is that there are a few things, two or three things. One is, if you keep going back to the core, to the sort of the axioms, if you want to call it that, in any theory or any development, it is the belief in the law of karma and the theory of karma. Associated closely with it is the belief in reincarnation, including the what is it that will end the cycle of rebirths. All the Indian religious philosophies, all of them share these as a common. There are some variations, but pretty much these are the building blocks. And if you can say almost that the thought that has been developed elsewhere are quite differentiated in that these are not the starting points. And the third is our, again, almost all the Indian streams, is the firm belief in the role of the guru in both comprehending what we are all about, what life is all about, and also in putting, bringing to an end the cycle of births and rebirths. So this guru has no simple translation in English. You know, very nicely Swamiji explained how culture and Sanskriti can be taken to be approximately the same. But there is no simple translation for the word guru, at least I am not familiar with it. Teacher is acharya, that is different. So we have this notion, mostly every Indian understands what it is. It doesn't matter, it could be Jainism, Buddhism, Sikhism, Hinduism, or any stream of Hinduism, everybody understands what this is all about. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa was a guru in the best tradition of the, you know, the quintessential meaning of the term. So was Swami Vivekananda. And then in our own area in the south, in this part of this country, sort of in a continuum, if you want to call it that way, contemporary or following Swamiji, Swami Vivekananda ji, there were many, and there are many gurus who are very relevant to a certain small number of people, may not be known in a sort of a public way, but more well known, you had Ramana Maharishi, you had Aurobindo, then you had Swami Sivananda. From this area, I'm just quickly recollecting. And then, of course, you also had the Paramacharya of Kanchi. And, you know, you can sort of almost bring it up to the current date this way. This is something fairly unique to this country. This is our heritage. I don't see this. You have teachers elsewhere. You have great teachers, but you don't have gurus. So this is sort of the three. Then the rest of it, you know, so many other things. Pretty much you can get it from any stream of thought. How one should live, how one should conduct oneself, and all those things. The last thing is, if you come down to the matters of our conduct of our day-to-day lives, science, mathematics, and so on, there again, slowly now, especially in the last 20, 30, 40 years, there is beginning to be some understanding that there might be some, again, fairly key differences in the way this was approached in this part of the world, in our heritage, and as opposed to elsewhere. In mathematics, this has become, in fact, a fairly now almost accepted. There is beginning to be a very clear, and almost accept now it's very well accepted, there is a thing called Indian mathematics. This is, I'm not referring to just simple methods and so on, you know, how do you do this multiplication, that addition. I don't mean that way. I mean a way of thinking, a mathematical way, a way of thinking about mathematics, which is now beginning to be seen to be different from the way mathematics has been approached from the Greek tradition. This is now, you know, almost reaching a stage where a lot of people are working on this and clarity is emerging. And it is important to understand this, because it's one thing to say, you know, that, you know, Bhaskara knew Pell's theorem before Pell and all that. Of course, it is true. If you take the Leelavati or if you take the Bijaganita, many things are there. It's also true that pretty much all the basic thinking that leads to calculus was there before Newton. And yet, of course, we did not develop calculus here. There could be many reasons for that. Could be that, you know, normally mathematics, music, science, all of these things require the economic condition of the area to be in reasonable shape. You know, these are not things that thrive in poverty. So maybe it was due to the economic decline, which also set in around 1600, 1700. Or maybe it was something else. Maybe it was because the, you know, science and all of this is about, you know, it's about the inquiry, discovery. These are all about also, you know, what motivates you to inquire, what motivates you to discover. So is there a difference in the motivational factor for inquiry and discovery in our heritage as opposed to elsewhere? This is a question that we have to ask ourselves. And is it because the motivational factors were different that certain lines of development stopped or went in a certain way rather than in a certain other way? These are all questions that I believe have not been answered. And We have to understand all this, only then we can begin to build on our heritage. Finally, I would like to leave you with the thought that this is going to become very important. This is something, all this what I have told you is pretty much a recounting of what is known. But I believe that this is going to become very important because of this whole emerging acceptance globally that we have to move or we have to relocate ourselves in a sustainable way of living. Now, if you take some known facts, everybody now, you take anybody, they start off their, whether it's in economics or whether it's in science, everybody will start off by saying that 25% of the world's GDP in 1600 was in India and another 25% was in China. So if you had 25% of the world's GDP and you had it for probably several centuries before that, if not for a whole millennium, that means you had a fairly sustainable, and if you did not, did not lead to a winding up of the civilization, it means you had a fairly sustainable way of living. So, if at all, or it may not have been sustainable, I mean, one should be very, very objective and one should be very wedded to the truth when one looks at, tries to look at these things. But there is some reason to investigate, inquire whether it was a very sustainable way of living. If that was so, then that is the only starting point the world has for how to figure out how to live in a sustainable fashion. Because in Europe, where the other major development in science and technology and this took place, it is all, they went from essentially a very low GDP and almost no productivity, so there of course it's sustainable, to what we have today from the Renaissance and the Industrial Revolution. And that is all, that has been a path of unsustainability. So there is nothing to go back, fall back there and say, okay, can they go back to figure out what was done in a millennium before that to figure out how one might think about a sustainable way of life? There is nothing there. Here there might have been. There's a good chance there was. So it may become very important for the whole world. And it might be, just might be, that it was in this kind of foresight that people like Swami Vivekananda, when they mentioned that India will have to, it's not with sense of pride, it's not with the sense of us, but it's the sense of very, very fundamental way that India may have to, or in the thought that was developed here, I want to put it in a very impersonalized way, might be very important for the way forward, right? Because if you start thinking even about simple things, you just have to take a walk in Mylapore or Pelican in the older parts of the town, see those houses. How was the use, even such simple things, mundane things as, how do you design, how do you utilize space? How do you, right? How are those houses built? How do you utilize space? Do you have a dining room which is used only for 40 minutes a day? Do you have a bedroom which is used only for 8 hours a day? Right? How do you create a large space which is used for 16 hours a day? How do you put it to multiple uses? How do you suddenly organize a big wedding in the same space without having a separate? If you have to build something that will last, the only thing that was built in South India that lasted over centuries were the temples. There is nothing else. There is no palace left. There is no house left from those times where the GDP was 25% of the world GDP. There's nothing left. Obviously, only temples were built to last. And they were built with no expense spared. But they were put to such use. And of course, they are being put to such use over such a long time that you do any economics on that, you will find that the return on investment is extremely high, to say the least. Today, all these skyscrapers, they only calculate 50 years. You don't even know what to do with the rubble after that. So, these are all things to think about. I am very wary about asking, letting people just, sit back and sort of pat ourselves on the back for our, that hardly matters, what our past is, what really important is, are there streams of thought here, streams of thinking, ways of thinking that will be important in the future. With these thoughts, I'll leave you to, I'll hand over the stage to the main event of the day, which is the speech by Sri Saddhartha Ranade. Thank you very much.